Welcome to Trinity.
It's great to have you with us.
Hello.
Welcome to Trinity.
We're so glad
you're here.
Hey guys, welcome to Trinity Church, where everybody is somebody.
Welcome to Trinity, everyone.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to Trinity.
Welcome to Trinity.
Happy Sunday.
Welcome to church.
Morning, everyone. Welcome to Trinity.
Hi, this is Paul and Matt, Bella and Ruby the dog, and welcome to Trinity Church.
Hello everyone, welcome to Trinity Church Nottingham.
Hey, so great to have you here at Trinity, you are so welcome.
Welcome to Trinity.
Good morning everybody, welcome to church.
Welcome to Trinity from Newport Beach, California.
Welcome to Trinity Church Nottingham.
We're so glad you're here.
Welcome to church.
Hi there everyone, and welcome to Trinity.
It is so good to have you with us today.
Welcome to Trinity Church Nottingham. We're happy to have you with us.
Welcome to Trinity. It's so great to have you with us. I hope you've all got a free ride.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity.
Hello, good morning. Welcome to Trinity Church Nottingham. My name's Amy and this is Johnny. If this is the first time that you are joining us, then you are very welcome. We're really pleased that you are here with us. Johnny's going to pray for us and then we're going to worship together through singing, and then Johnny's going to speak to us a bit later as well.
Yes, so why don't we pray? And even as we do, we recognise that these are strange conditions. And that we're not used to, even after these months doing it this way, it still feels strange to be praying in this way. But we expect today that despite the strangeness of this environment, that you are working, that you are active, and that as your word said, God, we will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And today, Father, we pray that by your Holy Spirit, the love of Jesus would be poured out amongst those, all those who watch this. And we pray that you would grant good news, salvation today to each of us. Meet us, God, in our weakness, in our brokenness, in our vulnerability, in our pain. Meet us, God, in that place of need that we all have. Meet us, Holy Spirit, today. We come as we are. Lord, we're tired of pretending. Lord, we just come as we are today and we pray that you would meet us as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together to him.
Good morning, church. Good to be with you again. Wherever you are, why don't you join us in singing and worshiping God together?
Arise, my soul, remember this. He took my sin and he buried it. No longer I who live, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up. No, I won't boast, but in the cross that saved my soul, all else is lost. The grip of fear has no hold on me. So where, oh death, where is your sting? No longer I who live, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light.
of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory.
Sing this together.
Oh, all of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory. No longer I who live, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light. Woke up to see the light. Whoa, whoa. All of this for your glory. All of this for your glory. All of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory. No longer I who live, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light. Darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
It's running after me. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. The goodness of God. Oh, sing of your faithfulness. Oh, I'll sing of your kindness. I'll sing of your goodness. Jesus.
Yeah, Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your consistency, that when we call on your name, that you are there. And Lord, we thank you for your presence here right now. And I pray, Holy Spirit, would you come now, and would you flood this space, and would you flood every person's home, every bedroom, every kitchen, that are listening in to this right now. Holy Spirit, would you come? Would you come? And maybe even where you are, just simply whatever chaos you're in, or even in the silence, just close your eyes if you can, if you want, and just put your hands out in front of you and say, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and meet with me. Show me that you are close. And just the sense even that that I've got, just a reminder of Jesus, that he meets us in our mess. You know, that he doesn't require us to be perfect or have all of our stuff together, because that no one has their stuff together. But yet Jesus, we see just in the Gospels, don't we, just the way in which Jesus continually meets people in the middle of their mess, middle of their chaos. And so I just want to pray for those that feel that even the sense in which they're keeping God at arm's length, because you don't feel like God can come in, that he's going to disapprove of the situation that you're in or the mess that you feel you're in. That Jesus is knocking and he's saying, let me in, let me into that, let me into that. And so, Holy Spirit, we invite you in to our mess. We invite you into our chaos, God. And we thank you that you are good. Thank you that your words speak life. And so we pray your words now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank
you, Jesus. And we lean, Lord, today into that goodness. We remember those words in Psalm 27 that say, I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Be strong, take heart, and wait for the Lord. And Lord, we pray today for anyone watching this, anyone in our congregation or just watching this from afar who is struggling. Lord, particularly we want to pray for those who are struggling in mind with mental health challenges. We pray today, whether it be anxiety, depression, burnout, whether it be some other kind of a challenge to mental health, isolation, whatever it might be, Lord, we just pray now for grace to abound. We pray for the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, now we ask you to draw near. You are the counselor, the one who comes alongside us in our weakness, in our struggle. And we pray you would do that now for those in our congregation. And we pray too, in the same vein, for those in our city. And I just want to encourage you now, church, would you, just even as we're praying, would you name one person? Ask the Holy Spirit, who is it? Who is it, Lord, you're putting your finger on? Who do you want me to pray for? And just name them now before God. Lord, we pray for those people that we've named in our minds or out loud, who even now you've shown us may need assistance. Lord, we pray. We pray now, Holy Spirit, we thank you that you never stop at the doors of the church, but you are moving in the world, and we pray that you would meet the needs of those right now who are most challenged in this area. We pray for a movement of healing and wholeness in our city, young and old, rich and poor. Lord, we pray for all manner of people to be touched by your Spirit. And we want to see that across our nation. And so we pray, Lord, particularly now, for all of those involved in provision and partnership organizations which are seeking to meet the needs of people who are struggling in these areas. We pray blessing on them, favor on them, increase in effectiveness. We pray for greater engagement with their resources. We pray, Lord, again, just for the movement of your Holy Spirit to bring about a revival of wholeness and healing in this area. We pray this in Jesus' name. And we're going to gather up these prayers, praying the Lord's Prayer, which is a prayer asking God's kingdom to come. And God's kingdom coming looks like wholeness in every area. So let's pray that today, and particularly focusing in this area. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Brilliant. We are going to have a moment where we share the peace. But what we've been doing whilst we've been in this situation is we've been using this time just have a few moments to send a message of encouragement, or just send the word peace to somebody. We're going to do that right now, and then we'll come back. Thank you.
Wonderful. Well, welcome again. And we know that folks connecting with this who perhaps haven't regularly been to our congregation, we know there are people watching our Sunday services who have joined our congregation but have never been to our building, and we're just delighted to have you. As part of the family, we can't wait to meet you in person. And we are, let me tell you this, in all sincerity, we are longing for the day when we can look you in the eye and rather than looking at you through the barrel of this camera. Anyway, our vision here hasn't changed, even in lockdown. Our vision is to see the church on fire and the city alive. Folks, it's a vision for the renewal of our city, and it begins with us. It begins with God's people being renewed, but it spreads out. And it's a vision that is only possible with God. This vision is impossible unless God does the heavy lifting. I just want to encourage you, as your pastors, we want to encourage you, double down in these days into him. Just draw near to him. He is drawing near to us in these days, and it is our responsibility to respond by drawing near to him.
Yeah, just we say this every week, but again, if you are new, a really great way to connect here at Trinity, particularly right now, is to join one of our hubs. So if you were to go on the website, trinitychurchnottingham.org, you'll see a list of different hubs that you can join. It is not too late to join a hub. I'm sure every hub would be more than excited to have new people join. I think many are doing the prayer course at the moment, so please, connect in that way. And like Johnny said last week, you don't need to be you don't need to have gone to Trinity in the past to come and be part of one of these hubs. If you want to come for a time, for a season, whilst we're in this crazy time of cameras and online services, then please feel free to join a hub and get connected in that way as well.
Yeah, and the other fixed point in our week, as well as hubs and Sundays, is Wednesday evening where we pray together. I just want to remind you of that resource. I know many of you do check in with that, either in the time or later on. And just this last week, we had Ruth Rye sharing with us, particularly around her work with mental health. I'm going to be speaking about Ruth a little later through the sermon. But I just want to encourage you, those are really a key way to just keep tracking with what God's doing in our community. And we really appreciate that opportunity to do something live where we're in the moment and in some way responding to what God's doing in the moment. So please do check that out.
Even we had an interesting moment, didn't we?
There's been an intruder on almost every single time we've done that. It's usually the dog. But this Wednesday, wasn't it? Our daughter Grace, just a cameo. Let's just call it a cameo. And I think Heaven was laughing. We certainly were laughing. So do enjoy that. We're going to take up our offering now. And speaking of hilarity, God loves, it says in 1 Corinthians, I think, God loves a hilarious giver, a cheerful giver. So why don't we just give with gratitude and joy in our hearts? And if you're new to this community, this is just part of who we are. It's what we do. We want to be a generous people. And we practice generosity in the ways that we give to one another. And that includes our finances here. So just encourage you to engage with that. There's info on the screen about how you can do that. But as we do that, let me pray for these gifts. Yeah, Lord, we give in this way, not actually primarily to give to a church or even a physical community, a building or something similar, but actually to give to you. This is a way in which we show you that we love you. It's just devotion, God, poured out in action. And we pray that you would be pleased with the heart of devotion that we have as we offer ourselves to you today. And multiply these gifts that they may be useful for your strategic purpose in these days. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, we're going to have our reading, and then Johnny is going to speak to us.
Today's reading is taken from Luke 4, verses 14 to 18. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he had anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. This is the word of the Lord."
Thank you. Why don't we pray? Lord, as I bring this word today, my prayer is that it would touch the hearts and the lives of everybody who watches. Lord, I pray that we'd get beyond the words I'm speaking somehow into your heart. Lord, I don't want this to be just the recital of something that I've prepared, but I want it to be a moment of encounter with you. I can't facilitate that, but you can, and I pray that you would. Amen. Amen. Well, there was a time in our lives, Amy and my life, in early years of our marriage, actually, when we arrived in the United States. We often speak about it. And in that time, the entirety of my political knowledge was given to me by my experience of watching the 7 seasons of The West Wing. Now, if you haven't seen The West Wing, then you've missed out on the best television ever created. I'd go so far as to say your experience of life has been significantly diminished. Set in Washington, D.C., this sweeping story tells the narrative of fictional President Bartlett's reign, 2-term reign over the USA. Now, we started watching when we arrived in America, and the thing is, we knew nobody. We had literally had no friends in the whole nation, pretty much. And we actually used to watch it every single night, and we would call the members of the cast, we'd call them the family, with very, very little irony. Now, since then, I've actually learned one or two things about politics from outside the West Wing, and I've actually had to learn a little bit about politics in our own country, not just the story of what was been happening in America. And one of the things I've picked up over the last few years is the importance for political parties and political leaders, the importance of having a clear manifesto. Now, I don't know if you know what a manifesto is, but if you don't, here's the definition. It is a public declaration of policy and aims, especially one issued before an election by a political party or candidate. So the idea of a manifesto is, in the manifesto, this document, you as a leader or as a party are saying what you stand for. What, if you are elected, your time in office will be all about. And the word comes from the word manifestus, which is Latin, and it means to make clear, to make manifest. And the idea is that before an election, you say what you are going to try and bring about. Now, what needs to be made clear? What needs to be made manifest? Well, there's something regarding your inspiration. As political parties, political leaders, that's important. Something, too, about your identity. Who are you? That's important in election times. But something also about your intention. What are your aims? What are your intentions? These 3 things need to be stated and hopefully then acted out in and through a manifesto. Over these last few weeks, we've been looking at Luke's gospel, Luke chapter 4 in particular. And we've been saying that what we encounter from verses 14 onward is Jesus, this leader who arrives on the scene in Palestine and who shares and states a clear manifesto. Last week, we looked at the idea that what Jesus is doing is, in the core of his manifesto, is to offer new sight. He promises that the moment of his manifesto is a moment of jubilee. It's a moment of justice when God's kingdom is about to break in. And as we said, as Mark said last week, that centers around recovery of sight for people who have had their vision obscured. And in order to do that, Jesus shakes his people. He shakes what's going on? And he's been doing that in these days. Mark helped us to see, I think, last week, about how shaking leads to seeing. We've seen that over the last period of time. But that was also what Jesus was doing. He shook the structures of the society to which he came. This week, what we're going to do is to discover that we're not just called to observe, that is to see the new kingdom, but we are called to participate in it as his people. His manifesto is a manifesto for people to join in and participate in the kingdom work. And in fact, that we are, as his people, anointed. I'll come in a minute to what that means, but we are anointed to bring good news to the poor. We are to embody this manifesto in our own lives. In other words, we might say, shaking leads to seeing, but seeing must lead to sharing. But before we get to what that looks like for us, we need to ask, what was Jesus meaning in the first instance when he spoke about himself? And here's what we read in Luke 4. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written. So Jesus, the context here is that it says Jesus was teaching in the synagogues. Now, the tense that's used here is an ongoing tense, an imperfect tense. It means an action which begins and is not completed. In other words, Jesus was, he made it his practice to go and teach in the synagogues. This is something he did on a number of occasions. And in fact, he was clearly good at it because people praise him for it. And what we find from verse 16 onward is that Jesus, as part of that general practice, goes on a particular occasion back into his hometown to give a particular sermon to his people. And he's handed the scroll. He's given the authority and the moment and the lights, if you can imagine, shine on him. And Jesus finds the place in the scroll where, of scroll of Isaiah, chapter 61, and begins to unpack it. Now, that wouldn't be easy to do, but Jesus knows the scriptures so well. And he opens up from Isaiah and begins to speak out this prophetic picture of what God's future will look like. This manifesto, this prophetic manifesto in Isaiah, and he claims it as his own. And here's what we see him read. And I want to focus, I think, on three aspects of this from just this first line, verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. One verse, even half a verse, but there's three things that we see. And the first thing, we see that Jesus says something here about his inspiration. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, he says. Now, the Spirit of the Lord is all over the early chapters of Luke's gospel. It was the Spirit of God, by the Spirit of God, that Jesus was conceived in the womb of his mother Mary. We see that Jesus, at his baptism in Luke 3, was anointed by the Spirit of God. We see that Jesus in the wilderness in Luke 4 was prepared by the Spirit of God. It says in 4 verse 1 that he was full of the Holy Spirit, and he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness. Jesus was prepared by the Holy Spirit. He was empowered by the Holy Spirit. Verse 14 of chapter 4, we've just read it. He returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. And here we see that Jesus is compelled by the Spirit. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. One scholar said, this implies a compelling force rather than an indwelling. We've seen that Jesus is indwelled by the Spirit, but here we see that the Spirit is upon him. There is a compelling force of the Holy Spirit upon Jesus for a particular purpose. In other words, Jesus' inspiration, at the beginning of his manifesto, what we find is Jesus stating his inspiration. And his inspiration is the Holy Spirit. Jesus' inspiration is and was the Holy Spirit. Jesus did nothing without the Spirit of God speaking it, empowering it, compelling it. at the heart of the manifesto of the kingdom is the reality of the Holy Spirit. And we as a church need to know that, because in this Pentecost season, we need to lean into the Holy Spirit like never before. Church, a revival is coming, but it is a revival that will depend on the strategies of heaven, the power of heaven. We cannot make it there in our own strength. It is from him. It is of him. And Jesus models the way. His kingdom is empowered and compelled by the Spirit of God. There's something there about his inspiration. But actually, something here that's very clear about his identity. He says, because he has anointed me. Jesus says that somebody, the Spirit of God, the one who sent him, has anointed him. This is an insight into Jesus' identity. Now, the word anointed comes from a Greek word, krio. And that's the word from, it means anointed. That's the word from which we get the word Christ, which literally means anointed one or Messiah. Now, to be anointed was to be a kingly figure, because what would happen is if you were being prepared or it was being prophesied over you that you would be a king, somebody would break, usually a prophet, would break a jar of oil over your head, setting you apart for that particular ministry as king. Now, Israel in this time had been waiting, not just for a run-of-the-mill king, but the ultimate king who was prophesied and promised for generations beforehand, for whom they'd been waiting over 400 years. And that king was going to establish God's kingdom on earth as it was in heaven. They were awaiting Israel's true king, a leader who would rescue them fully and finally from the oppression under which they had been laboring for many, many years. And we see an insight in Luke 3 where Jesus is baptized, this moment of heavenly anointing. The clouds part. The voice of the Father says, "This is my Son, whom I love, in whom I'm well pleased." And the Spirit of God descends upon Jesus in the form of a dove, anointing him as this king, as Israel's true king. But not only that, this king is the earth's true king, because this king is the Creator God in flesh. At the heart of the kingdom message is the idea that in Jesus, God has come to take control of creation again. He is the true king. This is something about his identity. Jesus states in his manifesto, his inspiration, the Holy Spirit, his identity is the one who's been anointed as Israel's true king and creation's king. But he doesn't stop there. He begins to speak into, in his manifesto, his intention. And here we see his intention. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. First of all, Jesus' intention is that he wants to bring, to proclaim good news. Good news, the word gospel. He wants to bring gospel. He wants to bring good news. Now, this word in the culture of the time would have been widely known that when gospel was sent out, it was usually an announcement that the emperor had some kind of, a child who would be in the future the emperor, or perhaps that the emperor had been enthroned. That was what gospel was in this culture. It was about the moment of arrival of a king. In contemporary Greek, it denoted weighty, authoritative, royal or official message. It was a powerful declaration of a new reality coming to place, and it had to do with kingship. It had to do with power. It had to do with authority. That was what gospel was all about. This is a message of the coming of a king, of the coming of the kingdom. But look at this. That's what the gospel is. But look at the audience to whom it comes. That's significant to say before I get into that, actually. Notice here that it's good news. Gospel is good news. It's not good advice. We often get this wrong, don't we? But the gospel was a piece of news. And when a piece of news comes, it doesn't demand that you do something. It just demands that you receive it. You become a hearer of it. This gospel was, for those who would hear it, good news. And the proper response to good news is always celebration. What we find, though, with this good news is that it isn't necessarily good news to the powerful. It is good news to the poor. Those who should be receiving this as good news aren't the ones who are going to directly benefit from a new emperor over the region, but it's those who are going to benefit from Jesus' coming kingdom. And they are described clearly here as the poor. Who are these people? Who are the poor to whom Jesus refers? The poor are the recipients of the good news. They are those, not only those who are economically impoverished, but all those who are marginal or excluded from human fellowship, the outcast. They are the losers in the competitive race for scarce resources, economic security, honor, and power. Their only recourse is to look to God for help. The poor are the losers in the rat race. They're the marginalized, the outsiders, the marginal people, the ones for whom society isn't primarily set up, the ones who have to work doubly as hard to make it in the world, and even then, who are discriminated against. So in this culture, poverty wasn't, at least in this sense, wasn't a function necessarily of economic acumen or resource, although that was part of it. But it had to do with education, with gender, with family heritage, with religious purity, with vocation, and so on. It was to do with status, and it was to do with honor. And one scholar says this: by directing his good news to these people, Jesus indicates his refusal to recognize those socially determined boundaries, asserting instead that even these outsiders are the objects of divine grace. Others may regard such people as beyond the pale of salvation, but God has opened a way for them to belong to God's family. But it's more than that. It's not just that these people can belong, it's that these are the ones to whom the gospel of the kingdom, the announcement of the coming king, is aimed. They're the first in line. It's not that just this news will trickle down. This kingdom manifesto is not capitalist. In other words, it doesn't begin, or it's not birthed in trickle-down economics. It's a complete upside-down kingdom. Our kingdom, the kingdom of capitalism, says if we make enough people at the top of the pyramid wealthy, then eventually the money will trickle down to the lower echelons. By the way, it's never worked. The gospel of the kingdom says the reverse. It turns the pyramid on its head and it says we're going to resource with God's blessing those who are poor, those who are marginalized, those who are outcasts. We're going to put them first in line. Jesus in his kingdom manifesto is saying these are the ones who are first in line. My kingdom, he says, is intended to benefit such people because it is a public announcement of the fact that those whom the world who is called outsiders are being welcomed into the inside of the family of God. Those who the world has dishonored are being placed in the seat of honor. Because receiving the kingdom doesn't require you to measure up. It simply requires you to be open and hungry. And often it's the poor, the those who are on the outside, who are most open and most hungry. Encountering this in our Bibles should give us pause for thought. It should make those of us who are in the family of God already ask the question, who are the poor? And how is my life positioned toward them? Who are they? Who are the ones that God now in Christ is announcing the message of the kingdom to? Who are the ones? Is it not the victims of any and every injustice? Is it not the victims of racial justice, of domestic violence, of modern slavery? Is it not those who struggle and suffer under the burden of poor mental health? Is it not the elderly, marginalized in a society in which youth and good looks are prioritized rather than wisdom? Is it not the economically poor? Is it not sometimes the economically rich? Enslaved in the palaces of their own making, isolated from true relationship? Is it not children in abusive situations? Is it not the prisoners? in the prisons, prisoners of their own previous mistakes. We could go on. But understand this, the gospel, the good news of the king and his kingdom is biased toward those poor. It's biased toward those who are outsiders, who the world sees with dishonor. And if the gospel we preach, and in fact, if the faith and the gospel we carry is not heard as good news by those people who Jesus describes as poor, then it is not the gospel that we are carrying. Let me say that again. If the gospel we preach and the lives we live as Christians is not received as good news by those on the outside, those on the margin, then it is not the gospel that we're carrying. If our churches are not places of welcome to the outsiders, then they are not filled with the presence of God, however nice our meetings may feel. Because if Jesus' ministry is positioned and aimed at the poor, then our lives and our churches must also be. The question then is, what might this look like for us? And I want to tell a story as we look at that, as I come into land. And it's the story of Ruth Rice. And you can hear her story on our most recent prayer meeting. In fact, you can read it in her book, which is available at the moment on Amazon. And just a great read. Please do check that out. But Ruth is a member of our church. And let's begin with her inspiration. Let's put it through the categories we've spoken about. Around 12 years ago, after 20 years of primary school teaching, Ruth experienced what she described as a massive breakdown. A breakdown in her emotional and mental health. And she spent the best part of a year in bed. She experienced a deep sense of shame because she was experiencing this breakdown as somebody who had grown up in the church. And she felt she should have been resilient to this kind of thing. She said that the lights had gone off. And in the midst of this crisis, this dark wilderness, you might call it, she discovered that the spirituality that she developed over many years, she described herself as somebody from the Brethren in recovery. She's discovered that her spirituality, which was based on serving God with all that she had, praying long and hard and leading in the church, all of this great stuff, she said that that spirituality was completely useless to her in her crisis. All of it fell to the wayside, and she was left in her bed, broken, crying out for God. And in fact, she even lost her voice. It was impossible for her even to cry out. But around and during that time, there was a moment of encounter where she felt God holding her close in his arms, saying, "Ruth, I couldn't love you anymore, and I'll never love you any less." You see what's happened in her poverty. In her poverty, the Spirit of God inspired her. Inspiration, by the way, that means to breathe into. The Spirit of God breathed into her. She experienced and received the gospel as good news for her. She had always been good news for everyone else, but in that moment, it became good news to her. And she said, "I was born again that day." I would say that was a moment of inspiration. And just like Jesus was in that moment, she was compelled not just to receive that for herself, but to do something about it for others. She developed by God's grace over a season, a vision for a place where it would be okay not to be okay, because there was a king who had come for the people who aren't okay, for the poor, for the marginalized. That was her inspiration. And she began to hear God speak to her words of identity. And she began to feel the Spirit of God anointing her. And she spoke to us this last Wednesday. And as she was leading us in prayer, only the word coming through my mind she was leading us was, "This woman is anointed. This woman is anointed for this." It was a powerful time of prayer. And she opened a cafe space at the invitation of a local cafe in West Bridgeford, who said, "Look, we've got lots of people coming, and many of them are isolated. Would you open a cafe where people who are isolated in and around us could come and find home?" And so she did. And it began to prosper. And at the heart of it was this rhythm, simple rhythm of prayer that she herself had discovered. And what she found is that when a space was created for the poor,
around prayer, around the presence of God, that people would come, they would find home, and they would find faith in Jesus. She had an inspiration. She experienced alongside that a new identity, a new authority and anointing. And she gathered an intention. Her intention was clear, to bring good news in this way, particularly to those with mental health challenges and renew well-being. A charity was born, and alongside this cafe have sprouted up since 50 other cafes. They think that was by the beginning of lockdown. They think that actually there may be another 50 by the time lockdown is over. And the message was this: it was good news to the poor, which was that a community of hope was being born in the middle of the world. A community which was there for the people who knew they weren't okay, but who were hungry to meet with others and to meet with God. And God has used that and profoundly spread that message so that there's this place of hope in the middle of the world. She is a leader among us. This is what God is doing in these days. Now, we're not all going to do that. We're not all going to have that exact story. But I can tell you with confidence that it is in the moments of my greatest poverty that God has done his greatest work in me, his work of inspiration, his work of anointing and of clarifying my identity and also my intention and my calling. I was bullied remorselessly through my teen years. It was in that very space that I began to cry out to God, begin to learn how to feed on the scripture, begin to draw near to him. My faith fell apart. I've shared this to you in my late teens and early 20s. And it was in that moment, again, that God began to put foundations in me. And I will say that this last 12 weeks of lockdown has been the most challenging time for me personally, as God has just stripped back and worked in painful and personal ways on my core. And I don't know what the result of this is going to be, but I know he's been at it, and I know it will be about inspiration. And the blessing, if there is a blessing to be reaped, it will be a blessing of good news for the poor. We don't have to launch a national charity. We don't have to plant a church. Some of us will. But we all have to live lives which are good news to the poor. That mandate is on every Christian, whoever you are. And so today, Christian, follower of Christ, member of Trinity, receive the inspiration of the Spirit of God. Church, the Spirit of God is on us, compelling us for this. This good news is in your hands. Don't wait for the institution to do something. This is about individuals and institutions moving with the Holy Spirit as he anoints us for his work. Church, receive the inspiration. Church, know your identity. This is who we are. We are the King. We are King Jesus's people, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. You are anointed to bring good news to the poor. Church, follow this manifesto. Follow Jesus' intent. He is good news to the poor, to those on the margins who don't feel at home. Because he has done everything required for every person to become a friend of God, all we need to do is accept it. And he offered this message to the poor first. This is our message. This is the message on our lips and the message in our hands. For some of us, it will mean crossing the street to smile at someone. For some of us, it will mean a simple and small act of kindness. For some, befriending someone different to us or someone who we know has no other friends. For some of us, it's just making friends with our neighbors, the people who we've ignored because we've been too busy. For some of us, it is following a radical call to rearranging our lives. But whatever it is, church, let us take up in the inspiration of the Spirit, the anointing of our new identity, and the intention of this kingdom manifesto. Let's take up the gospel, which is good news to the poor, in our hands and in our hearts. Amen. Amen. And why don't we pray? Amy's going to join me. As we do this, let's just pray now. Father God, only by your Spirit not by might, not by power, but by your Spirit. Lord, just release now the winds of compassion, the winds of compassion to blow across this place, blow across in our houses, wherever we're watching this on our mobile devices, on the bus, on the train, in our car, as we're listening to this, wherever we are, God, would you release now your anointing, your inspiration? Holy Spirit, come. We thank you for the examples we've seen of this. We thank you for Ruth's example. We thank you for the example of many others in our city over generations. We just think of William Booth, Catherine Booth, I think that was that were their names. She just founded the Salvation Army because the wind and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit blew upon them and enabled them to see ministry, a reimagined ministry to the poor, a good news to the poor. Lord, I pray now that you would do something in our community, in our congregation, that would mean we were changed forever. Lord, in the slowdown of lockdown, that you would actually be using this to build up the church and build up Trinity Church specifically. And I want to pray for pioneers in our congregation who, in humility, but with great passion, could carry this good news message to the poor in and from this moment. Anoint them now.
And yeah, even just when Johnny was sharing about Ruth's story, where Ruth felt God say, Ruth, I couldn't love you anymore and I'll never love you any less. I just wonder for some, you know, if it starts with us, for some today need to receive that truth, that word from God again, either for the first time or for just the millionth time, to just sit in that truth that you are loved. He couldn't love you any more and he will never love you any less. And so even just repeat that. You might want to even say it out loud. Cover yourself in that truth because that is the truth. That is what God says about you. That is what God says about me. That is what God says about Johnny. And that is the starting point. That is the starting point of anything that we are to do. And so, Lord, we receive your unconditional love right now. We thank you, God, that you cannot love us. You will never love us anymore. You've made that clear already through Jesus. And you will never love us any less. And so, Lord, we receive that. We receive that today. And I pray everyone across this city who is listening right now, I pray, God, for hearts to just to soak that truth in to the deepest parts of their being now. Amen.
Yeah, and I just really want to encourage you just to continue processing this, particularly in your fuse, in your hubs. But also we have a moment now where actually folks can be prayed for specifically. And we've just heard stories of those engaging with this through Zoom in the last few weeks, just having profound prophetic encounters. As your pastors, we want to urge you now, take this opportunity. This could be a moment of transformation in your life. Your life might never be the same because of the words God speaks into you right now. Take this opportunity. Don't be passive. Become active in your own transformation now. Get involved. Dial up the information on the screen that we can just join in with that. This is the moment. Now is the moment of salvation. Now is the moment of a consecration. And God is just beginning to send us. And I think there's this moment of inspiration and anointing and just us picking up a new intention for our lives and coming alongside with Jesus Manifesto. And it's amazing. You preach a sermon and you're immediately aware of all the ways you could have done it better. But hopefully it's just been clear that I just think now is a moment where God is just wanting to speak this stuff into us. Yeah. We're going to worship. Before we worship, do you want to say anything else, Amy? Okay, we're going to worship. But just those of us that are engaging with that, go for it. Just begin to pray this through as we worship. But also, let's just receive prayer too. Let's sing.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
You could imagine.
Could imagine so great a mercy. What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who sent me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who sent me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declare the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declare the grave has no claim. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who sent me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are our living hope.
Well, we are now coming to the end of our service. Johnny is going to pray a blessing over us, but we are so grateful that you have been able to join us this morning. And like Johnny said, you know, it's not too late to receive prayer. So go and do that, or call someone, get into your hub, whatever it looks like, to respond and to continue talking about this. But we'll see you either on Wednesday for prayer, 8 till 9, or next Sunday. Have a great week.
Yes, so on our closing prayer, Father, we thank that you are our living hope. And by the Holy Spirit, you're pouring out hope every day for each of us to catch. And I pray, Lord, that you, the God of hope, would fill your people with hope and love and faith this week and always. And God's people said, amen. Receive that blessing and go in peace. We love you. We'll see you soon.